In May 1981, the city of Atlanta was in a state of panic. Over the last 2 years, 26 black children had been murdered. The police seemed powerless. Most were boys between 7 and 14. Most had been strangled. Extra police kept watch on key locations like the Jackson Parkway Bridge over the Chattahoochee River. In the early hours of the 22nd of May, policemen on the watch heard a splash and found this car stopped near the bridge. Its driver was a 22-year-old black man named Wayne Williams. In the car, the police found some rope and a bloodstain on the front seat. But this was not enough to detain him, and they had to let him go. The police investigation had begun in July 1979 with the discovery of the bodies of two teenage boys. Edward Smith Jr., aged 14, had been shot. Frogmen found his body in the river, along with another body, that of a 13-year-old named James Evans, who had been asphyxiated. They had gone missing from their homes in Atlanta earlier in the week. These bodies didn't attract much attention at the time. Inquiries were routine and ineffective. There seemed to be few clues for the police to go on. Patrolmen were alerted, but this didn't stop the disappearance in October of another 14-year-old, Milton Harvey, who had wandered from home and whose skeletal remains were found the following month. The disappearance of 9-year-old Youssef, son of civil rights worker Camille Bell, raised the alarm. She described what had happened.
Down, and the lady who lived next door to us then asked, could he go to the store for her? He went to the store, and he didn't come back.
On the 8th of November, Youssef's strangled body was found under the floor of an abandoned school. Civic leaders were horrified.
There is something sick about people who would snatch out the lives of little children.
Then came a girl. 12-year-old Angel Lanier, found tied to a tree, raped and strangled on the 10th of March 1980. One day later, 10-year-old Jeffrey Mathis disappeared. And 8 days after that, Eric Middlebrook, aged 15, was found bludgeoned and stabbed to death. When three more died or disappeared, their parents formed a committee to stop the slaughter. They demanded an increase in police commitment, which consisted at that time of only 5 officers.
There is someone in this city who is picking up boys, black, between the ages of 8 and 12. Little boys on the streets are not safe alone anymore.
Racial overtones were introduced when the police were accused of making too little effort because the victims were black.
But there is no evidence that we've been able to get at this time to suggest that it is true.
The task force was housed in a tiny basement room in the city police department. A sergeant and 4 helpers had only 6 phones for thousands of calls a week. Tension increased when a boiler exploded in a daycare center, killing 4 small black children and a teacher. It seemed like an accident, but some parents refused to believe that the explosion wasn't linked to the missing and murdered children.
How many children are going to have to lose their lives before you, Mayor Jackson, you're not hearing us. You're saying you're concerned. Well, I'm concerned. Everyone here is concerned. You know, we don't want to see you on TV, and we don't want to see you at voting time. We want to see you now about our children. And I know you're in a bad spot. But that's the price you pay when you're on the other side.
The city's officials were under intense pressure. Friction grew when some claimed that the killer must be white. But as the murder toll grew, others said that only a black person could have won the confidence of so many black children to be in a position to abduct them. Frustration was affecting the police department too. Mike Edwards, head of the criminal investigation unit, walked out after an argument over policy.
The other thing is that a missing child is really not considered a crime. So at that time, we had a number of children counted missing that are not handled by homicide. And in order for them to recognize the problem, you had to put the two together.
Phone-in programs kept the pressure on figures such as Public Safety Commissioner Lee Brown.
I would like to know why so many black kids have, you know, had to die before anyone got really interested in, you know, solving, you know, wondering what happened to them, you know. I mean, a bunch of them died before anyone got interested, you know, just because they're black kids.
From our perspective, we became concerned when we had the death of the first black child. Anytime there's a child or any person who loses their life, it's a very serious matter. We have devoted, even before establishing our special task force, literally thousands of investigative hours attempting to resolve the case.
The 12th victim of the elusive killer was Clifford Jones, aged 13. He disappeared on the 20th of August and was found strangled the next day. His mother said she had no reason to worry about letting him out alone.
But I didn't know that there was nobody around here killing up, you know, black kids. If I had to know that, I'd never let Clifford out the house.
The police task force was increased to 25 officers, stretching the department's resources and budget to breaking point. But despite the alert and all the warnings, young black boys still continued to disappear from the streets of Atlanta. During the fall and winter of 1980, the killer appeared to have claimed five more victims. By the spring, there were 20 unsolved murders. At last, the city and the nation took resolute action. Atlanta put up a reward of $100,000. Mayor Maynard Jackson went on TV.
Somebody, somewhere out there knows what we're looking for, knows who's doing this insane series of acts and attacks on our children. $100,000 will shake that information loose.
Muhammad Ali increased the reward by a further $400,000. Firemen volunteered to join police in their door-to-door search for information. So did a psychic, who claimed to have previously helped to solve 14 murders. The regular police were supplemented by 35 agents from the FBI, who were permanently stationed in the city. $20,000 people were interviewed face-to-face, and another 150,000 by phone. George Bush, then vice president, announced federal aid of $1.5 million.
We hope that this infusion of federal assistance will end the suffering for the families, and the trauma for this city, and indeed the trauma for the entire country, because, as I say, it's national.
A new spirit infused the searchers, determined to track down whoever was shaming their city. A rumor spread that the murders were part of a Ku Klux Klan attempt to exploit already fraught racial tensions. An 11 o'clock curfew was imposed on all black children aged 15 and younger. Vigilante patrols appeared on the streets.
Have fun, have a good time, but stay safe.
Atlanta's mayor, Maynard Jackson, launched a safe summer program with visits to recreation centers, which had been opened to provide closely supervised activities for children between the ages of 6 and 15. 8,000 children enrolled on the first day, but the authorities knew that nobody was safe yet. By the 22nd of May, six more had gone missing to add to the 20 known victims. But then the murders stopped after the splash heard on Jackson Parkway Bridge. The cops had had to let Wayne Williams go because they had no cause to hold him, but they followed him, kept him under observation, and started looking into his background. 23-year-old Wayne Bertram Williams was an only child whose parents lavished love and attention on him. He was bright, energetic, and ambitious. At the age of 12, he built and set up his own radio station. Among those he interviewed on it was Congressman Andrew Young.
At the time, I remember being extremely impressed that a 13-year-old kid would have a neighborhood radio station. He had a pretty professional-looking layout.
Then he became a freelance cameraman, selling film to local television stations. Jim Rutledge, a local producer, remembered him.
When I first met Wayne, he came in with his film camera and had a shot of an accident, and it was terrible footage, but it was the idea that he had something, and he was energetic.
Williams equipped his car with flashing lights and a police radio and was arrested for impersonating a police officer. Next, he set up as a musical impresario and leafleted schools, saying he was looking for young black talent to join a group he called Gemini, after his astrological sign. Two days later, a body washed up near the bridge. It was that of Nathaniel Cater, a 27-year-old known homosexual, older than the other victims, but undoubtedly killed by the same hand. After the splash, Wayne Williams had told the police that he was flagged down near the bridge when he was returning from a musical audition. He had not stopped on the bridge itself. But at the Georgia State Crime Lab, fibers from Williams' home and car apparently matched fibers on Cater's body. However, the evidence was still not enough to arrest Wayne Williams, and he was allowed to stay free, under surveillance. The net tightened after a witness said he had seen Williams and Cater at a movie theater, hand in hand, just before Cater disappeared. Now FBI agents were digging deeper into his past, discovering an interest in boys and youths that he claimed was purely to do with his music business. He seemed to enjoy the media attention and categorically denied any involvement in the abductions or killings. But with further investigation into his recent past, police found many suspicious links to the victims. At least one had auditioned for him at a local recording studio. He used this diner for a mailing address. Two of the victims turned out to be customers of it. He frequented gay bars and known cruising grounds for Atlanta's homosexuals like this corner. Here, in 1978, he had been an eyewitness of a fatal shooting at 2:30 a.m. He had a vicious streak. Despite his parents' financial support of his various schemes, he was seen punching his father for not giving him enough money. One witness said he saw Wayne slapping his mother as well. The efforts to link Williams with as many of the victims as possible took police to this housing project in southeast Atlanta, where he had distributed handbills, recruiting kids for a talent show he organized. One of the administrators recalls,
"Yes, he came to the office and asked us to distribute literature and to recruit kids for his talent show, and that he was a talent scout, and that he would be helping to develop their talent and put them in contact with the major companies and so forth."
On the 3rd of June, the police questioned him for 12 hours, but still couldn't pin the murders on him. They were forced to let him go at 3 a.m., hiding under a paper bag in the back seat of a car. Never shy of the press, Wayne Williams recorded this interview on the condition that his face wouldn't be filmed or photographed.
"They openly said, 'You killed Nathaniel Cater, and you know it, and you're lying to us.' They said that. And they said it on a number of occasions."
Now he was under constant observation from both the police and the media. He led police on a chase past the houses of their superiors and got 5 tickets for traffic violations. To tease the police that he might fly away, he made inquiries about chartering an aeroplane. But these games were brought to an end on the 18th of June, 1981, when the law struck at last, and he was arrested and charged with the slaying of Nathaniel Cater. Bail was refused, and 2 days later, a judge referred the case to a grand jury. Now a grand jury had to decide if there were a prima facie case to answer on the indictments chosen by the district attorney, the last two victims, Nathaniel Cater, whose body Williams was suspected of throwing into the river on the night the splash was heard, and Jimmy Ray Payne, who was fished out of the same river about a mile downstream 3 weeks before. Payne had been reported missing after he failed to turn up for a job interview. The police found a witness who claimed that he had seen Jimmy Ray Payne with Wayne Williams. Upset by a wave of what they regarded as prejudicial publicity, his lawyers came to court with Wayne's parents. They asked that any grand jury member influenced by it be disqualified. Williams was brought from jail for a bond hearing. He promised that if he was granted bail, he would stay in Atlanta and not attempt to influence witnesses. The opposing lawyers took their argument onto the streets. District Attorney Lewis Slayton was asked if Williams might flee.
Well, I think it's possible.
There's no reason to fear him at all. He's not, he hasn't committed any crime. He has not, there's been no proof that he has committed any crime.
Despite defense attorney Mary Welcome's confidence, the judge ruled that there would be no bail or bond, and he promised to poll the grand jury if he felt that publicity had influenced any decision they came to. The grand jury gave the go-ahead to proceed with the prosecutions. The Fulton County District Attorney announced the decision with some relief.
Count number one, causing the death of Jimmy Ray Payne by asphyxiating him with objects and by means which to the grand jury are unknown. Second count, accusing Mr. Williams of murder of Nathaniel Cato.
Public Safety Commissioner Lee Brown promised to keep investigating.
In the case of the tragedy we've been experiencing for the last almost 2 years, it's not over. We've made one arrest. We have 27 cases where we have not charged anyone. Our task force shall continue to work full speed ahead and even faster at this time until we can successfully bring closure to all of the cases.
Lewis Slayton was asked whether there had been pressure for an arrest.
I will say that there was no, that pressure or politics did not figure into the timing at all.
Wayne Williams' trial for the murders of Nathaniel Cato and Jimmy Ray Payne began on the 5th of January, 1982. The prosecution relied heavily on the hairs and fibers taken from his house and car in police searches. The results of those searches came in the testimony of Larry Peterson, the microanalyst at the Georgia State Crime Lab. He said that fibers and hairs found on the bodies matched those on the floorboard of Williams' car and may have come from carpets on the floor of his bedroom and from other rooms in the house, from a spread on Wayne's bed and a bath mat. There were also some similar to hairs from the family dog. Mary Welcome scoffed at the forensic evidence.
I think that any one of you, under the circumstances, could have killed Nathaniel Carter, because I'm sure that all of you have fibers in your hair of some sort that may match some of the fibers that were found.
With the case going badly for the prosecution, it asked Judge Clarence Cooper to allow the introduction of evidence linking Williams with 10 of the other murders. This would reveal a bent of mind, promised Assistant District Attorney Joe Drelay, adding that all the other victims had fibers and hairs on their bodies that matched those found in the house and car. And in some cases, there were eyewitnesses who could place Williams with the victims. The prosecution made its plea to introduce the additional testimony after the judge had sent the jury out of the courtroom. Defense counsel Alvin Binder objected to evidence being presented about crimes with which Williams was not charged. But Judge Cooper ruled that he would allow the new evidence. It was a turning point in the trial. Testimony about Williams' sexual leanings was given by this anonymous 15-year-old. He said he was picked up by Williams at this shopping center during the summer of 1980. Williams invited him into his car with the promise of a job, but then made sexual advances to him. Asked to identify the man who propositioned him, he pointed to the accused, saying, "I can't forget his face. It makes me sick." He said he ran from the parked car when Williams said he had to get something out of the trunk. Wayne Williams took the stand for 3 days. He denied meeting any of the victims or that he was a homosexual. He claimed that he had been set up and was totally innocent. About the night he was picked up on the bridge, he claimed he had a perfectly good reason for stopping.
When I crossed it, I stopped on the other side of the bridge because I was trying to find the sheet of paper I had the number written on before I got to the telephone. I stopped maybe about 10 or 15 seconds.
But under cross-examination, he seemed to change from a quiet, middle-class youth to a streetwise smarty, confirming the prosecution's contention that he was a Jekyll and Hyde figure. Goaded by the prosecutor, he screamed, "None of the witnesses saw me on that bridge. Nobody saw me throw anything off that bridge." He then went on, "Nobody saw me kill anybody. All you got is a bunch of hearsay mess. And he burst into tears as he left the witness stand. After 9 weeks and nearly 200 witnesses, Williams was led out and the jury of 8 blacks and 4 whites retired on the 27th of February. Only 12 hours later, they returned with their verdict. Guilty on both counts of murder. The general opinion was that they had been convinced not by the evidence, but by the fact that the murders had ceased when Williams was arrested. Judge Cooper sentenced Wayne Williams to 2 consecutive terms of life imprisonment. With great relief, jubilant investigators closed the file on the killings, and Safety Commissioner Lee Brown made it official.
With the conviction of Wayne Williams, we have reviewed all of the evidence that's present today, and as a result, we've cleared 23 cases.
In other words, we think he did them all. This was confirmed when reporters asked if Williams would be charged with any of the other murders.
We don't have any present plans of bringing any further indictments in Fulton County.
This was the opinion of District Attorney Lewis Slayton, as Wayne Williams was taken away to jail for life twice over. He was confident that the killer had been caught. The case was closed.
The evidence showed that there's been 13 killings in 5 months in 1981. At that time, we identified the defendant. There has been no other killing since that time that fits the pattern.
But was justice really done? A new team of attorneys prepared an appeal. A distinguished committee included author James Baldwin, TV producer Abby Mann, civil rights specialist James Kunstler, and Harvard Law School's Alan Dershowitz. They claimed that police withheld evidence of a Ku Klux Klan suspect.
Let's have a fair fight, let's have a true scientific test, and let the chips fall where they may without any loaded dice.
But despite these brave words, the appeal was unsuccessful. The sentence confirmed by the Georgia Supreme Court in 1983. Wayne Williams remains in jail and may well be there for the rest of his life.
Tuesday's Great Crimes and Trials double continues after the break with the 1966 police killing that shocked the nation. When 3 officers were gunned down in West London, 2 suspects were quickly apprehended, but a third went on the run for over 3 months. The full story of the Braybrook Street Massacre, that's next.